to this incarnation of the Fold Festival. My name is Kat Germain. I'm your audio describer for this improvised audio description. This is going to be a 30-minute presentation from 2:30 until 3 o'clock. And I'm not sure what we are in for this afternoon. Previously, the feed was divided into 9 rectangles. The center rectangle showcased the speaker, and the other 8 were feeds from Vancouver, Winnipeg, Toronto, Kingston, Montreal, New York City, Halifax, and London, UK. And within each of those rectangles, there were more rectangles within, showing each of the speakers and what their screens were showing. So I suspect the beginning and the end of this performance will probably offer the same visuals. And I suspect, I believe that the way today is going to work is each of those cities is going to have, 3 to 5 minutes for their presentation that I believe they started working on just today. And when those are being viewed by the audience, then they will take up the full screen. The time now is 2:27, and I will join you again when something's happening. And on screen are 9 rectangles. The rectangular screen is split up with 9 rectangles.
Hello, everyone. Welcome or welcome back if you were with us yesterday and Wednesday. My name is Chantal Bilodeau. I am a co-curator of the Green Rooms.
Hi, everyone. I'm Sarah Garton Stanley, and I'm also a co-curator for the Green Rooms. It's really great to be back for this final gathering on the third day of the Green Rooms. The Earth is watching. Let's act.
The Green Rooms are produced by English Theatre at the National Arts Centre and presented by Folda in collaboration with the Canada Council for the Arts, the City of Kingston, the National Theatre School, and HowlRound Theatre Commons.
Yeah, the City of Kingston have been a really steady partner throughout this whole adventure. And in fact, initially, we thought that we would be many of us here on the ground in Kingston, in Cataraqui. And so it makes perfect sense, as it always should, to acknowledge that we are on the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee, and the Huron-Wendat. It's a real privilege and a pleasure to be able to make work here. And I personally happen to be here. And as Chantal likes to say, Mission Control also happens to be here. Although another big part of it is in Ottawa on Algonquin Anishinaabe territory as well, unceded territory. So we're so happy to be here with you all today for this closing act.
This is the last day. We had a series of conversations yesterday. We had a dance party. We had a big opening picnic on Wednesday. And we just before we move to our final act, actually, we want to reflect a little bit on what we were hoping to accomplish with the Green Rooms and where we got to. So, of course, it had to change along the way because of the COVID pandemic and not being able to gather in person. So as it changed, one of our big goals became how do we gather when we can't gather in person? We also wanted to explore the role and responsibility of the theater in addressing the climate crisis. Another goal that sort of evolved along the way was how can we highlight the different separate issues that are social issues that are actually manifestation of the same problem. How can we look at them together? How can we see how they feed how they feed on each other, and how sometimes addressing one can actually help make all of them better. And along the same lines, we wanted to respond to the current moment.
Yeah, it's really still quite clear in my mind the feelings around that week, March 16th through to sort of the 22nd, and a feeling of paralysis and uncertainty as the news about COVID-19 really started to flood all of the stations, all of the airwaves, all of the internet. It was just everywhere, and sort of a sense of paralysis and unknown about what the future would be. What would June 10th to the 12th feel like, look like? And I know that Chantal and I spent quite a lot of kind of bug-eyed moments kind of looking at each other similarly on computers as we are now, but really wrestling with how to keep the question of this climate crisis as part of all of the other concerns and fears that we were confronting at that time. And then of course, very recently, the incredible upswell of protest and clear thinking around white supremacy and anti-Black racist kind of actions and needs for change in terms of structurally and personally, interpersonally. And so how to think about the questions of the climate amid this moment as well. So it's been an unbelievable privilege and also an incredible challenge, I think, for us in the best way, along with Sophie Trobe, our associate curator, and the curatorial team, who have been so hugely supportive in trying to understand how best to keep space alive for all the different ways to apprehend and consider this question of the climate crisis that is so very, very present amidst all of the other questions that we, as in North America in particular, are really dealing with right now. So Chantal, where did we get to?
Well, maybe, you know, we should be asking, but I mean, from our point of view, we had some really difficult and honest conversations, and we hope that what you can take with this is different perspectives on how to think about the climate crisis. There's not just one way of approaching it. It was said over and over again, it's not, the impact is not the same across the board. You know, different people are impacted differently. And it's good to keep in mind these different perspectives and these different realities as we move forward. And another thing we hope you get is good food for thought about where we can go from here individually and collectively.
So as we were building towards this moment, we approached a number of artists, wide-ranging group of artists, to ask them to consider responding to this question of climate change. And we'd really like to show them to you now.
On screen text, we asked a bunch of artists to respond to the question of climate change right now. The following artists responded to our ask.
Ani, Corey Ndishnikas. My name is Corey Payette. My background is Oji-Cree First Nations, and I'm artistic director of Urban Inc. I'm a playwright, composer, and director based on the unceded territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh First Nations on Coast Salish territories in Vancouver, East Van. I would say that this time that we're in has shown me that we are capable of enormous change collectively. And so witnessing what has happened around the world in this time has actually given me a lot of hope for the climate change movement, in that if we can make this kind of radical change right now towards this crisis, then we can make that change as it relates to climate change. And so I'm not deterred. I feel hopeful, and that the possibilities of change seem closer to me than ever.
How has the pandemic changed how I feel about climate change?
Deborah Pearson. Looking out over a balcony, we do not see Deborah.
I don't think it has. I think we need to change everything, but I've thought that for a while, and this has been a painful way to find out. Okay. Bye-bye, Garton.
ASL signer, my name is Landon Krentz. He signs. On screen text, I am a theater artist from Calgary, Alberta. The COVID-19 had a negative impact on the theater communities across Canada. In particular, I'm especially concerned about the deaf theater communities, because we, deaf people, have already struggled and do not have conceptual, several of my artistic opportunities have been canceled. However, when one door closes and another opens, we will break through. I have noticed that most of my work are more digital, creating new works, building stories, and other opportunities. Therefore, it's vital that I remain connected to my deaf community and feel a sense of belonging.
My name's Marcus Youssef. I'm a playwright and theater maker based in Vancouver, British Columbia. And I think the best way to kind of illustrate how the pandemic has changed my relationship to the climate crisis is by showing you this.
This is my travel and tickets email
computer
folder.
Screen.
One I've taken great secret kind of egotistical pride in for about a decade. It's got every single itinerary for every bit of travel, mostly work, occasional pleasure, but mostly work over the last 10 years. The first one is a canceled car reservation in March. And then it's every single travel ticket I've had in 10 years.
He scrolls through emails on a computer.
None of which I'm doing anymore. Most of them flights.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm Mary Vingo.
And I'm Laura Vingo Cram.
And we're related.
Chantal.
I'm a director playwright.
And I'm a theater director, and we're both based in Halifax, Nova Scotia.
For me, coming out of this pandemic, one of the things that's really changed for me is I can hear the bird song. I've gotten to know a cardinal in my backyard, and we meet every morning. And I could never hear him before because of the traffic. And so the fact that there's been this slowdown has been a ray of hope. It's made me think that maybe we can stop driving so much, we can stop flying so much, we can eat more locally sourced food and give the planet a break.
This pandemic has really given me space to think about who I am in society. I think as an artist, I was doing that, but before it was a constant rat race to cobble together a living from various different contracts and employment. And now with the CERB, I have $2,000 regular a month to actually think about.
For four months.
I know it's going to end, but I actually have time to think about things a little bit more deeply and, exercising my democratic right and getting more involved, signing petitions and writing to my MP, all things that, I was sort of doing before, but now I really feel...
Are you going to keep doing them, Laura? Are you going to keep doing them?
Yeah, well, I wonder if, have I started a new habit, so that's good.
Starting a new habit.
Yeah.
On the darker side, of course, we have lost so many of our elders during this time, and we've lost them under deplorable conditions in the long-term care facilities. Laura and I have had some exposure to those long-term care facilities. We know how stretched they were before this happened, and now, of course, they just crumbled, and it was an accident waiting to happen. Willful blindness on the part of all of us, I guess. We all have to take responsibility. So that's something that I'm hoping will come out of this. We will, the same willful blindness that has left us with climate change has left us with this nightmare, and hopefully we'll come out seeing a little more clearly about what's really important and valuable to us as a society on this very fragile planet.
Yeah.
Okay.
My name is Yvette Nolan. I'm a playwright living in Saskatoon right now. I recently wrote a land acknowledgement for a short play festival in which the character enumerated the things that the pandemic had done for the earth. Fewer planes in the air, fewer cars on the road, fewer ships in the seaways, whales swimming freely, foxes on the boardwalk in Toronto, bears everywhere. While we, the creatures who are responsible, are on a timeout, you just sit there and think about what you've done. I'm thinking. I hope the people with power are also taking the pause, taking the opportunity to rethink how we go forward. It's too late for some things. We're never going back to the way it was. April was the warmest April ever, globally, in spite of the timeout. So we must adapt. But the pause has shown us that we can, if we must. And we must.
My name is Adrienne Wong. I am a parent, an artist, and artistic director of Spiderweb Show Performance. I'm living in Banff, Alberta. I find myself thinking about how quickly the world, the earth, its waterways have restored themselves, I don't know, without all of our economic consumer activity in this pause of the pandemic. And I'm also thinking about how many sweeping changes have been put into place under the rubric of protecting us from this pandemic. And so I know we can do it. I know we can do it. We can make these changes on a large scale. It's just a matter of doing it. Thank you.
Hello. Greetings from Beaver Creek in Treaty One territory on the shore of beautiful Lake Winnipeg. My name's Debbie. Now, for me, climate justice and disability justice are kind of like this, because at the core of ableism is this belief that a human being's value is based on our ability to work or earn a living or produce things. And that same kind of thinking applied to the land leads us to see the land merely as valuable for the riches it is able to yield up to us, right? And so right now we're in this moment where human well-being is perceived to be more important than human productivity. And we're all freaking out because our internalized ableism is rearing up and going, well, who am I if I'm not producing? And what value do I have if I'm non-essential? And if I can't work, do I even exist? So there's this like desperation to keep working any way we can, to just keep producing stuff. And I mean, like look at the lake. Like, it's perfect. And right now, it's not yielding up its fish. It's not transporting our goods. It's not even a playground for our canoes and kayaks and motorboats. It's just sitting there. But it has value and purpose and meaning and presence. It's magnificent.
Kia ora. My name's Elspeth. I am in Aotearoa, New Zealand, and I teach and produce creative activism. Before lockdown, we were working on a biting satire of unsustainable consumerism called Desperate Antics by New Zealand playwright Kevin Keyes. We tried to turn it into a radio play, but when we glimpsed everyone's private lives via Zoom, it turned out that there are massive disparities between who does or doesn't have good internet or a safe space in their home to create work. Lockdown floodlit inequalities, and yes, they fell along racial fault lines, with Indigenous and migrant households disproportionately affected. Lockdown helped me see my own privilege and better grasp the inequality that had been right under my nose all along. So my focus while the theatre is dark has been on developing robust evaluation measures for inclusiveness. We need to measure not only theatre's contribution to climate action, but the interrelated areas of race and gender disparity. How inclusive are we really? Evaluation is not the fun part of creative work, but we are going to need it more than ever if we are going to be able to keep working on the things that matter.
On Screen Text, with thanks to Corey Payette, Deborah Pearson, Ledin Krentz, Marcus Youssef, Mary Vingo, Laura Vingo Cram, Yvette Nolan, Adrian Wong, Debbie Patterson, Elspeth Tilley. Back to the nine rectangles on screen, Sarah and Chantal in the middle.
Hello and welcome back. I'm Sarah Garton Stanley, one of the associate curators here in the green rooms, and I'm joined here in this space with...
I'm Chantal Bilodeau, the other co-curator of this green room.
So we just wanted to take a second to talk about some of the people in the videos that you just saw, and in particular, Elsbeth Tilley, who ended the range of videos. Elsbeth is from Wellington, New Zealand, at the Massey University, and she was a huge supporter of the earlier iteration of the green rooms when we were actually going to be on the ground in 8 different spaces, and one of the locations was going to be in her theater space. So it was really wonderful to be able to somehow bring her here to be part of the closing act. And we listed the names of all the people on the cards, on the credit card at the end for all the people who were able to contribute. And we're so grateful for those thoughts and the time that they took to do that. For the closing act, which is upcoming, we asked participants and facilitators in the 8 Zoom rooms, which represent 8 cities from across Canada, London, and New York, to create something for you. And when we say create, we largely mean improvise. It's a 5 to 7 minute response to the highlights and questions and themes that have emerged over the last 2 days. And we've also asked Matt Rogalsky, whom you can't see, but it's been very much in the background, and who you've heard so much of his sound supporting us through this 3-day adventure, to provide some of the sounds that will be joining us in this closing act. We're really excited to share this with you. We're really grateful to the participants for being game. And also, we're very inspired by so many of the thinkers and speakers, and right from starting with our keynote on the first day with Ariel Deranger, and right through to the end of last night with Donna Michelle St. Bernard and Jordan Tannehill, just a range of incredible speakers, which of course all was kicked off by Knowledge Keeper and Georgina Riel, artist, community builder, Georgina Riel, who will be joining us to close at the end of this session. We've been so inspired, and in particular, I was struck, and I think we all have been struck by many different things, but I was struck by when Dr. Jennifer Atkinson spoke about how to overcome grief, or not overcome, I should say, she said, let's sit in it, how to work with grief is to act. And so that in part inspired our thinking about having a closing act. Chantal?
Very well said. And yeah, the closing act is, you know, we worked on it briefly before this, so it's as much of a surprise for us as it will be for you, and we hope you enjoy it.
On screen text, closing act, superimposed over the brick wall that is beside a doorway that above reads stage door, and through the doorway are pink, purple and orange clouds as if they are being lit by a sunrise or a sunset. Around this are 8 different screens, each representing the 8 areas. They're all doing different things, and within those rectangles, everybody within there are doing different things as well. Top right corner is predominantly a person's hand, very close to the camera. You can see their knuckles. It's not a tight fist, but a fist.
Hello, I'm here in Halifax. Hello, I'm Tara Wright, and I'm in Halifax. Hello.
Hello.
Hello. I'm Murdoch.
My name is Stuart
Legere,
and I'm in Halifax.
Hello, my name is...
Hello, my name is Tracy.
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 as the soundscape seems to be continual, describe some of the visuals on the screen. At the bottom, the group there are bent arms doing motions in front of their faces, some similar to swimming. On the bottom right corner, the three people there are moving very close to their cameras and moving back with large smiles on their faces. Moving up around, going counterclockwise on the far right center section, there are several words that people have written. One says, computer and performance allow us to model a new approach to a sustainable and just world. Several more screens now are showing words. Top right is change as hard as we've been made to believe. Is our local cultural survival connected to the global survival of our planet? What work do you need to do to create the change you want to be and see? Which action can I implement today to move towards positive change? Will it be enough? Can universal basic income, sorry, it's gone from screen, I can't read it anymore. Can I move from an ego system thinking to an ecosystem thinking? What will I need to teach the children in my life? The visuals of the handwritten notes continue to show across the screen, some of which are many, most of which I can't read. They're either very small or they're quite light.
I've forgotten who said it, but my point is,
how can I hear better, fully? How can theater makers serve neighbors using practices of community self-governance, self-governance to mend ecosystems? Can we keep checking in? This is the community we've created here. Build meaningful relationships by showing up and doing the dishes. Perhaps the structures we live in, I don't trust listening.
Perhaps the structures that we live within have prevented us from seeing what it is.
Evolutions are long and they're messy. This is going to be a long haul. I just want to make sure that we do it right.
What structures are limiting our listening?
Scientists need us, the artists, to bring the emotion, the love, and the meanings
don't address how these facts
are.
Yes,
yep.
I do.
Okay. All right, and Deborah, we're going to move to the big room all together.
All right, thanks, folks. Here we go. Let's go to the other room.
Okay, so and now good. We're going to transition to
exactly.
Tino. All right.
A series of photographs cycle through the center screen. I believe these are all people who have been involved in the Folda Festival, Aaron Ball, Don and Michelle Bernard, Sophie Traub, Man in a Forest, gentleman with a white hat, white presenting woman with curly hair, headshot of a person smiling, LAL, the duo musician group with face masks, Marcus Cyrus Ware, Sarah Garton Stanley. These photographs continue.
I was just going to contact her and see.
Martin Jones.
Derek Chan, Georgina, Molly Brayman,
Did you just record me?
Someone did.
I was just gonna contact Garton and see if
I'm there.
I believe this is the keynote speaker, sits in front of a window with light-colored curtains. Smoke billows, wisps in front of their face. They reach to the side of their camera. They wear black framed glasses, long black straight hair with a little bit of white gray framing their face.
Honey, bonjour. Babishki makakwe and dishnakas and kinakdoem, Bawari and Dinjaba. So, as I did in the beginning, I introduced myself to you in my traditional name. It means white bear woman. I am from Bajuan First Nations of the Ojibwas, which is located in Sault Ste. Marie. But I've been a resident here in Kingston for the last 18 years. And this place is called Gatarakwe, which is known as a gathering place, which is very fitting for what we've been doing here for the last 3 days. So as we did in the beginning, I always start off in a good way. And I start off with a smudge because we're going to share some good words to close this wonderful festival.
They take off the glasses, put the smoke near their eyes, their ears, in front of their mouth, waft it over their head. She picks up a feather, looks to the sky.
So what I did is I made sure that I cleansed my eyes, my ears, my mouth, my nose, and my heart, because I'm going to be speaking in a good way. This was an extremely fulfilling 3 days for everybody that participated. I'm very grateful to everybody that was the hosts, everybody who spoke, everybody who shared messages in the chat rooms. Especially grateful to the partners, the hosts, the people who are behind the scenes. Chimigwich, Matt, for that beautiful ending video that you provided. We shared so many words. It was, as I mentioned before, this was one of the most stripped down, raw conversations everybody had. And I think personally, it's because if we're not in a room together, we don't feel as vulnerable. And I think it's really interesting that as artists, we do find ourselves in many situations where we are vulnerable. And then sometimes that's when our best work comes out, is when we let ourselves get to that space. So as we walk very carefully on these ancestral lands, as we talk about the various subject matters, in particular climate change, and how it affects us on a personal level, how it affects us on a daily basis, that we must be mindful that our ancestors are watching. For me, my ancestors are the ones that are rooted in the ground, the ones that are in the air, the winged ones, the ones that are in the waters, who are the fish. We are also giving thanks to the creepy crawlers that are in the earth, but also to our four-legged ancestors and us humans. So as we gather all of our thoughts today, there were some significant words that I wanted to point out that was shared in many things. And it was brought up multiple times about oppression and racism and systemic and climate and the environment and the fiscal responsibility that we have. At the end of the day, whether we are professionals or living our daily life, we must be responsible, not just for us here in the present day, but for our future people who we must keep a very healthy and safe and clean earth. That's our duties. So if we were in person at this point, I'd always say, you know, look around and let's give thanks to the people who are here with us today. And however you came to this gathering place that I know it's got a rock, I ask you to walk carefully, to give thanks, and appreciate each and every one of us. From my heart, miigwech, which means thank you. But I say big thank you. And I saw this during the video, and I saw beautiful hands sharing up. So I give big thanks to everybody that participated over the last 3 days. Miigwech.
She waves with both hands and smiles. Looks down, purses her lips. There are now about 25 small rectangles on screen now. Each person is in their own rectangle. And now, superimposed on the brick wall, it says, thank you. This is Kat Germain, your describer for today's largely improvised performance and entirely improvised description. There are still some more happenings for the Fold the Festival. There is one this evening with critically acclaimed blind artist Alex Ballmer. Her show is called May I Take Your Arm? And you can find it by going to folda.ca/accessibility. There is, I believe, an audio described introduction to the show, but the show primarily has audio description embedded. It's integrated audio description. And yeah, sorry, to find it, folda.ca/accessibility. And thank you for listening this afternoon. I hope you enjoyed the show, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the Fold Festival. Once again, this is Kat Germain. And if you have any questions or comments, you can always email me at kat, K-A-T, at katgermain.com. That's K-A-T-G-E-R-M-A-I-N.com. Have a great afternoon.